Here. Good. Yep, good. Well, I can't give you anything. A little piano introduction about this tempo. Bop, do, da, do, do, da. I can't give you anything. A little four bars. Thank you.
think it would work. It's okay.
Now is the moment, now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Join me. Now is the moment, now is the time. This very day is jubilation. I'm telling you, now is the moment, now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation. Now is the moment. Now is the time. This very day is jubilation.
To pray, open your whole self to sky, to earth, to sun, to moon, to one whole voice that is you. And know there is more that you can't see, can't hear, can't know, except in moments steadily growing and in languages that aren't always sound, but are other circles of motion. Like the eagle that Sunday morning over Salt River, circled in blue sky, in wind, swept our hearts clean with sacred wings. We see you. We see ourselves and know that we must take the utmost care and kindness in all things. Breathe in, knowing we are made of all this, and breathe out, knowing we are truly blessed because we were born and die within a true circle of motion, like eagle rounding out the morning inside us. We pray that it will be done in beauty, in beauty.
As we breathe in those words and breathe out our cares and our interesting circumstances of last week, we come together with great joy. Welcome to Sacred Journey. This morning, we are so privileged to have two very special people with us. One is James Schattauer, who is an amazing musician that many of you know better than I do, so you can agree with me that he's an amazing musician. Welcome, James. The other is our very dear friend, our sister Stephanie Escher, who is an amazing preacher and baker woman of God. Welcome, Stephanie. As we move through this day, you are invited to think of your journey as not just your journey alone, but your journey with all of God's people to this moment in time when we're together again around the table. Can you give a little love? Can you give a little peace? Can you give a little friendship? Can you give a little kindness? Then let's stand to our feet and give a little.
If we all can hear the call, many hands will make the work light. We can reach our goal with heart and soul, climbing up one step at a time. Here you go. I can give a little, you can give a little, together we can give a lot. I can love a little, you can love a little, together we can love a lot. And as we look in each other's eyes, we can see that the future is bright. There's a master plan, a guiding hand, and love will be the seeds that we sow. I can love a little, you can give a little, together we can give a lot. I can love a little, you can love a little, together we can love a lot. If we were willing, love could be spilling all over the world. Oh, I can give a little, you can give a little, together we can give a lot. I can love a little, you can love a little, together we can love a lot. We can love a lot. One more time. We can love a lot.
You may be seated. So I invite you into a few moments of centering to settle into your chair. And this morning, I invite you to feel your heart in the center of your chest. Just visualize it there. And visualize the love that's planted firmly in your heart. And now I invite you to open your heart and let it expand. And feel your heart connecting with the person sitting next to you, and then expanding wider so that your love, your heart is connected with the heart and love of every person in this room and embedded in the heart of everyone across the planet and all of creation, the love that spreads throughout the east and the west, the north and the south, above us, below us, and within us.
You plant a seed, watch it grow. What will it be? You may never know. You have a need, then let it show. Open up your heart, let someone know. If you love your life, you will use it. Living and giving for today. 'Cause if you keep your heart, you will lose it. Don't be saving for a rainy day. Finding love means giving it away. Love was never kept in a tomb, behind a wall, or inside a room. So never try to keep it in. You will lose the fight. You'll never win. If you love your life, you will use it. Living and giving for today. If you keep your heart, you will lose it. Don't be saving for a rainy day. Finding love means giving it away. And as you find the ones that you love along the way, make sure you tell them each and every day. So plant a seed, watch it grow. What will it be? You may never know. You have a need, then let it show. Open up your heart, let someone know. If you love your life, you will use it. Living and giving for today. 'Cause if you keep your heart, you will lose it. Don't be saving for a rainy day. Finding love means giving it away. I invite you to join me on this last part. It sounds like this. Finding love means giving it away. Try that with me. Finding love means giving it away. Now just this half. Finding love means finding love means giving it away.
And let us unite our voices as we pray these words together. Let us pray. Holy One, as we plant seeds to nurture and sustain the future of our sacred community, plant a seed of love in our hearts. Let it take root. Let it grow in us. May we water and tend it so that a blossom of extravagant love sprouts into full flowering in us. Amen.
I'm Kale.
And I'm Brooke, and this is Ronya. We've been coming to Hennepin since July 2013 and just became members about a year ago. I think it's important for us that Ronya be raised in a church home that we would go to regularly, and she would see the same people from week to week and have her church friends get involved in youth group and mission trips so that she knows that God loves her and God loves everybody, and then she can also show that love to her neighbors and friends and strangers that she doesn't know.
So that was 2 years ago, and as you can see, our family's grown since then.
Ronya is 2.5 years and Ravel is 1 month, and we're excited to watch them grow at Hennepin Avenue United Methodist Church.
Are you gonna sit by Mama? Over the last couple years, we've really enjoyed deepening friendships with the people that we've met at church, and we feel that the sermons are just really
relevant.
Yeah, relevant and topical to what's going on in the world. We've really enjoyed being part of a team, a great cause.
It's been great having kids at Hennepin. We felt very welcome throughout the process. It's a good way to connect with members. Haven't ever felt pushed aside or like we need to be somewhere else.
So as a mom of two young girls, it's really great when Ronya is telling us that she's really excited to go to church. She's really engaged in the Frolic Bible and some of the other books. And she's excited to go and see her friend at Life Group. And she just really enjoys the excellent care in the nursery.
As a family, we frequently go down to brunch at Hennepin and really feel that's a great way for us to connect with the community and neighborhood around the church.
We had a really great time this year hosting a Trunk for Trunk or Treat. As dentists, we provided toothbrushes, toothpaste, and floss, and decorated our trunk like a giant mouth. So that was just really a fun and great way to serve our neighborhood and do some neighborhood outreach. There's not just one reason that we support Hennepin financially, but a whole host of reasons.
We realize it's a great opportunity for us to raise our kids within a faith community, and Hennepin fits us the best.
Feels like home.
Wow. Raise your hand if you had that experience in the last 30 or 40 or 50 years. You raised your children here at Hennepin. Yeah. It really ranks true. My name is Janet Pollack, and I am the Staff Parish Relations Chair. And if you don't speak Methodist discipline, that's the HR committee. and I am here to talk to you today about your commitment for 2019. We realize that in the last 18 months, we have come to you three different times asking for your generosity. In February of last year, you pledged to the capital funds of $4.2 million to provide renovation and maintenance to this beautiful building. Then in November of last year, you made your annual commitment for the operations of the church community of almost $1.6 million. And then this past spring, you offered up another $2.1 million to make sure that this building stands forever. Thank you very much. And now we come to you for your 2019 commitment. Keep in mind that the funds we raised from the last several months cannot be used, from the capital campaign, cannot be used for our church community's operations. We hope that you will be equally generous this year. But before that, you make your commitment. I'm sure you're all wondering, where does all that money go? Over half of your pledges go to the general operation and expense of what we do at Hennepin. Postage, utilities, supplies, insurance, apportionments, building expenses, musicians, and marketing. Did you know it costs roughly $1,000 to clear the parking lot every time it snows? Remember April? The balance of your giving, however, 47%, pays for the staff that make Hennepin happen. In all, we have 16 full-time and part-time employees. They clean the restrooms, shovel the sidewalks, vacuum the floors, and make the coffee on Sunday morning. They greet you and our visitors from our reception desk and make sure that the bulletins are designed and printed and the sound system is working properly each Sunday. But of course, that's not all. The staff parish relations portion of your pledge also covers all our program staff, our new music director, our three full-time ministers, our director of children ministries, and the director of the Dignity Center, as well as several others. Your generous contribution ensures that the work of Hennepin, our outreach, visits to the infirmed, children, youth, and adult education, and the worship services we experience each Sunday dig deep into our souls to create an intergenerational community with open hearts that serve with passion. Please consider your commitment carefully. If you made a commitment in the past, we hope you will do so again this year. And keep in mind, if you aren't a member of Hennepin, you can still make an annual contribution. With your commitment in 2019, we hope to expand the marketing and social media initiatives that we began in 2018. Additionally, we are working to close the wage gap between our current hourly rates and what will eventually be a living wage required by the city of Minneapolis. And we would like to broaden our youth ministries. Your giving is changing lives by making God's love real to people. Making a decision to support God's work by giving regularly helps us to plan and use our resources wisely. If you did make a financial commitment last year, please consider increasing it this year. Because of you, we can achieve our mission to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And after all, is there anything better than that? Thank you so much.
Good morning. Moving on from money to things that count now. We're going to read, or I'm going to read, you're going to listen, to Luke 6, 31 through 38. Treat others just as you want to be treated. If you love only someone who loves you, will God praise you for that? Even scoundrels love people who love them. If you are kind only to someone who is kind to you, will God be pleased with you for that? Even rascals are kind to people who are kind to them. If you lend money only to someone you think will pay you back, will God be pleased with you for that? If you lend money to someone you think will pay you back, will God be pleased with you for that? Even lawbreakers lend to lawbreakers because they think they will get it all back. But love your enemies and be good to them. Lend without expecting to be paid back. Then you will get a great reward, and you will be the true children of God in heaven. God is good even to people who are unthankful and cruel. Have pity on others just as God has pity on you. Jesus said, "Don't judge others, and God won't judge you. Don't be hard on others, and God won't be hard on you. Forgive others, and others will forgive you. If you give to others, you will be given a full amount in return. It will be packed down, shaken together, and spilling over into your lap. The way you treat others is the way you will be treated." This is the word of God for the people of God.
And each one of you is truly a word of God for God's people, for our world. And in that spirit, I invite you to stand and to greet one another with words of welcome and peace. Welcome to all of you worshiping with us via live stream. We're glad that you're a part of our community this morning. Blessings to you. Namaste and peace.
Good, man. How are you? Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Falling all over town. Be sure that your umbrella is upside down. Trade them for a package of sunshine and flowers. If you want the things you love, you must have showers. So when you hear it thunder, don't run under a tree. It'll be pennies from heaven for you and me. Sunshine and flowers. If you want the things you love, you must have showers. So when you hear it thunder, don't run under a tree. There'll be pennies from heaven for you and me. There'll be pennies from heaven for you.
Good morning. You all look lovely. Today is Commitment Sunday, and we are invited through our spiritual practice of giving to lift up our shared vision of the world and see it as God does. Our stewardship theme this past month has focused on kitchen table giving. Understanding that the conversations and activities that take place around the intimacy of the kitchen table form our values and practices for how we live and move and have our being. How we spend our money is one way we tell the story of who we are and whose we are. And money is not our only currency to invest. Our investment of time, talent, as well as our resources tell our larger story as followers of Jesus, who taught us through word and action that the way to abundant life is through a practice of radical generosity that involves giving away your life again and again, that it is in the service of self-emptying love that we are filled with even more love still, as that lovely song this morning illustrated. Thank you. This morning, I invite you to expand your kitchen table just a bit larger, to include our migrant brothers and sisters in search of asylum at the U.S.-Mexican border, and in particularity, the children, as we gather around their stories, struggles, and hopes. I am privileged to partner in the Ministry of Pilgrimage with Heartbeat Journey, a nonprofit organization founded by John Philip Newell, a Celtic scholar and minister. We recently expanded our peace pilgrimage model to engage systemic social injustice and humanitarian crises in our time. Through a combination of volunteer service, protest, prayer, witness, education from local migrant activists, fundraising, and accompaniment, we commenced our first Heartbeat border pilgrimage 3 weeks ago. Our driving mission was to respond with an all-in generosity that required nothing less than the whole of our lives, mind, body, and heart, as we engage the needs of migrants, asylum seekers, and refugees who are crossing the U.S.-Mexico border at Ciudad Juarez and El Paso, Texas. We served at the Annunciation House in El Paso, a designated respite center that cares for 400 to 600 people each week as they make their way through the region. We also volunteered at a similar respite center, Casa del Migrante in Ciudad Juarez. Knowing this community as I do, and also knowing that pictures tell wider and deeper stories than words alone, I have created a short video with photos, many taken by my pilgrim colleague, Emily Scott, among others. I invite you now to enter into this life at the border as Jesus taught us, eyes and hearts wide open.
Oh,
We attended a rally at the Tent City in Torneo, Texas, where approximately 2,000 children, separated from their parents, are being housed. We learned that the number will rise to 3,800 by the end of this month. In the greater U.S., there are now nearly 13,000 migrant children in detention centers and shelters, the largest population ever, whose numbers have increased more than fivefold since last year. These children either came to the United States with their parents legally seeking asylum and refuge from their homeland, or they were sent here for safety by loving and fearful parents. Torneo was originally intended to be operational for 30 days as a temporary shelter. At this point, it is designated to be operational until at least March of 2019. We learned that throughout the country, hundreds of children a week are taken in the middle of the night from licensed facilities and foster homes with operational and child welfare guidelines, including education and adequate access to legal assistance, and moved to the remote desert Tent City in Torneo with very little oversight and no access to education and legal assistance. Water must be trucked in and out. While the number of children crossing illegally or seeking asylum has not increased in recent months, the number of detained migrant children has spiked due to hateful rhetoric and policies that have made it harder to place children with sponsors. Potential sponsors are now required to have all members of their household fingerprinted and background checked, which means not only a longer detainment period for the children, but also a higher probability that many sponsors who are undocumented themselves will be deported. So the kids, they remain detained. Many, we are told, will most likely age out in the system. So, stories. While volunteering at Casa del Migrante in Ciudad Juarez, a respite center where refugees are welcomed and served every day, a couple of women who had heard we were there on a pilgrimage asked if they could speak with us. We met with Maribel from El Salvador and Amador from Guatemala while they watched their boys play in an outdoor area among children's toys and a swing set. Their boys, 4 and 7 years old, were playing, innocent, happy, unaware for now of all that their mothers have endured for their safety and future. Maribel and Amador immediately started asking questions. Are they going to take my son away when I get to the border? Why were so many people able to cross and live in America, but now all of a sudden children are being taken away? If they take my son away, I will die, I will die, Maribel proclaimed with tears streaming down her face. Our pilgrimage group had been gathering firsthand accounts of all that was happening in the border that week. We already knew that every day at the border is different. With the migrant caravan in the news constantly while we were in El Paso and Juarez, we knew that the border was being more heavily militarized. We chose our response carefully as we became more certain that all we could do was accompany these women and bear witness. We don't know what will happen when you get to the border, we said. Every day is different. Why are they separating families? That's not humane, said Maribel. I should just go back to El Salvador. Amador became nervous and said to us, no, no, I tell her she can't go. She can't possibly go back to El Salvador, just like I cannot go back to Guatemala. Maribel, we said, we don't know what will happen. We wish we could give you the right answers. We can tell you that there are people fighting for you and for everyone, for your families. Many people are standing up and speaking out against everything that is happening. They asked about our pilgrimage. We shared stories of our pilgrimage group united by our commitment to witness the border with our own eyes, to meet men and women with stories like hers, to return home and share the stories of what we have seen, to demand change to the injustices. We told her we'd been featured in the news down there. They were both excited about this. We showed them images of the newspaper article on his cell phone. And one of them asked, there are more Americans doing this? And we said, yes, a lot more. Maribel and Amador shared stories of the violence and poverty in their countries, the violence they personally endured, the fear for the safety of their children, and the desire to live in America with family that has lived here for years. Maribel said a man had held a gun to her head once and had hit her 4-year-old son. She'd also seen a man in the street with his throat slashed. She shook her head as if she could shake the traumatic memories away. Maribel left for a moment and Amador stayed talking with us. You know, she and I just met here yesterday. We were both hungry and tired from all the walking. Our sons, too, they don't know what's happening. They just follow us wherever we go. Amador said, I know Maribel wants to go back to El Salvador, but she can't. I tell her to think of her son as I think of mine. He doesn't know what's happening, and he's young, but I am teaching him good values. I'm teaching him that we try hard, work hard, don't give up, and keep moving forward with God. I can't give up. I can't turn around and go back. I'm afraid for our lives. I need to go to the border. And if they're taking away children, then I won't get closer, but I need to go. I need to try. As we said our goodbyes, the women asked us to share their stories, embraced and blessed us, and offered prayers for our pilgrimage. We were amazed and rendered speechless by their courage, their prayers for us after all they have endured and all the uncertainties they face. We who entered in to bless had been blessed. The Gospel of Luke today is all about the alternative economy of the kingdom of God that is based entirely on radical generosity. By giving away our lives, we will find life given back, but not merely given back, Jesus says, given back with bonus and blessing. My time at the border impacted me in ways deep and profound, and I am sure that it is because I entered in with the whole of my being and all of the love I had to offer. I was all in. As such, I have never known the depth of lament that washed over me while standing outside the children's tent city in Tornillo, nor the seething rage at powers and principalities who have succeeded in depersonalizing our most vulnerable neighbors to such degree that walls are built and arms are taken up to keep the other, the enemy, out. My friends, my heart broke, but not apart. It broke open in this way that love poured out, and as quickly as it poured out, more poured in. In the midst of all the suffering and pain, there were moments of the inbreaking of God's realm. These exquisite encounters with a love that knows no bounds and will not be held back. Moments of seeing and being seen, of true solidarity, of kindness and love reciprocated. And there was joy. The children I encountered continued to reflect light in their laughter, love of play, and welcome of the stranger, regardless of circumstance. Even in the deep despair of the border, the Spirit of God was winging betwixt and between, and we were held in grace. I was blessed in ways I can't begin to name, and my cup spills over. This morning, the table is set for our communion celebration. May we find bread for the journey as we continue to wage love in this now and not yet realm. As Jan Richardson writes, and the table will be wide, and the welcome will be wide, and the arms will open wide to gather us in, and our hearts will open wide to receive. And we will come as children who trust there is enough. And we will come unhindered and free. And our aching will be met with bread. And our sorrow will be met with wine. And we will open our hands to the feast without shame. And we will turn toward each other without fear. and we will give up our appetite for despair, and we will taste and know of delight. And we, my friends, we will become bread for a hungering world, and we will become drink for those who thirst, and the blessed will become the blessing, and everywhere will be the feast. May it be so, and thanks be to God. Amen. Today is a day for thanksgiving, yet there are those whose hearts and hope have been broken by the circumstances of their lives, and even those in this very room. As a community that believes in the power of prayer, we speak the names and concerns that make us cry for mercy and justice, for healing and peace, lifting them from the shadows and silence to the light and love that is God's love. Love that holds us all.
In this moment of space, where we are holding the world in our hands, what names do you speak before God?
Donald Trump.
Let us join our voices together. God of compassion, with your love to guide us, we can make whole what is shattered. For all that we have named and all that is still too painful to speak, help us to believe in healing that goes beyond the surface of lives and systems to restore the beauty of wholeness. Let courage and joy begin with us and spread throughout the world until your Jubilee vision becomes real for all people. Amen. The invitation has been given, and the circle is wide because indeed God's love is wide. Friends, know as you come to this table that this is the table of the God who loves you and knows you and holds you in God's hands. We come together to celebrate the sacred mystery. We celebrate the sacred presence. We bring our gifts of thanksgiving. We offer thanks and praise to you, living God, with hearts lifted high in the communion of your love. Like the pilgrims of yesterday, we seek life and find it in you among us. And so, with all the good gifts of creation, seen and unseen, with brothers and sisters from east and west, north and south, those who have gone before us and those who will come after us. The broken body of the world and all we hold in our prayers, we lift our heart song to you. Ancient of days, one before time, all that is burst with your presence. All who receive and share love in your name are blessed. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice.
We rejoice in the Spirit of God in all creation. We celebrate the world around us and all that is close to us in our lives, the vastness of the cosmos, the air we breathe.
The word which was and is to come, spoken in time to some, speaking beyond time for all, a word of thanksgiving and grace.
Take and eat, this is my body. Take and drink, this covenant is new, and remember all who receive are one.
For all who receive are new in Christ. We rejoice in the Spirit that lives in us and bring all that we are to be transformed, our happiness and laughter, our suffering and tears, the passion that moves us, the faith that calls us. We trust. Spirit of love, may this bread and all who receive it be aware and alive to all that is holy within us and all creation.
Spirit of life, may this cup be life to all who receive it. We pray to be refreshed and renewed, to become a gift to be shared with the world. Amen.
And we pray, our Creator throughout the heavens, hallowed be your name. In a trillion suns, your new world comes. In the tiniest cell, your will be done. Give us each day a bird in flight, a flower's perfume, a bright star's light. Lead us not on a path of greed. Teach us to tread lightly, to take what we need. For ours is a journey from ignorance to understanding, from separation to oneness with you, in the glorious energy of the universe. Amen. Friends, you are invited to come and receive what has been prepared for us, that meal which gives us not only nourishment, but which gives us strength and courage to do the work of God in the world. If you are serving this morning, I invite you to come forward and receive. There are two stations on the either side, and if you are gluten-free, Stephanie and I will serve you here at the center. As you come, you are invited to make your offering and make your gift for the ministries of this community of faith.
Thank you.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees with my face to the rising sun,
week we take a few minutes during this part of our service to recognize and celebrate those of you who have brought your own good news with you this morning into our circle. We want to know who among us this morning happens to be celebrating a birthday in these days, or the anniversary of some important event, the beginning or end of an important chapter in your life. Anything that's good news that you want us to know about, this is the time to let us know. You do that by coming up here, and we hear your good news, and then together we offer our blessing. So who has among us has good news to share this morning? Come on up.
Hi, I'm excited to share that this past week, my stepson Nathaniel, Scott's son, had the unfortunate of, in the process of needing to move out of an apartment in LA, lost his job in an instant. And we're excited to share that yesterday he had an interview and was hired on the spot. And we just hope more blessings that his search for an apartment lands in his lap.
I will be celebrating a birthday next week, and I turn 72, and so happy to be here, alive with my fabulous Australian husband. There you go.
David. I'm Debbie, and this is birthday week for me. Just want to also share a lot of my life. I shared my birthday with my mother. Her birthday was on the 22nd. She's been gone since I was 52, but she would have been 90 this year. Yay. So my birthday's on the 24th.
Grace wants me to tell you that she just turned 4.
I just had a birthday too. Woohoo!
One of my favorite mystics is Meister Eckhart. And he said, if I'm not younger today than I was yesterday, I should be ashamed of myself. So a year has passed for me, and I hope I am younger. I hope I'm a little wiser now that I'm 84.
Good morning, everybody. I'm here this morning to let everybody know that I'm going to be 57 years old on the 30th of November.
All right, so our blessing. You know it well. Those of you who have been here before, you extend your hands, you open your hearts, you sing the words, God grant you many years. God grant you. It appears as if our cup is indeed running over here.
There are many ways to be involved in the life and the work of this community this week. Next Sunday, our church is hosting or having a charge conference for the purpose of setting salaries for clergy. It'll be immediately after the 10 o'clock service. I hope you can stay for that. And there's a lot else going on next week. There's Christmas decorating. Those of you who like to string lights and decorate trees and so forth, 12:30 in the sanctuary, that group is meeting. And also next week starts 2 weeks of the Hennepin Marketplace and Book Fair that'll be taking place in Carlson Hall. Dana.
Oh, sure. A Christmas gathering at the Taylors. Some of you were there last Easter. Please come back. If you weren't there, please come.
That's Sunday, December 9th. Sorry. Yes.
Okay. Parking can be a bit tricky, and so if you're having a little trouble getting around, park at our service.
Ken.
A very quick announcement. Next Sunday, Karen, where are you? Karen and I will be selling tickets for the Jim Wallace event. Huge, huge thing. It will sell out. It is about racism. And we have a panel of amazing people that will be talking with Jim, and he will be speaking. And the thing about the books is that if you buy a ticket next week from us, you get the free book. I mean, you'll get the free book even if you come on the day of, but you know, then you could read the book before he's here January 12th. Okay? Thanks.
Ken.
Van volunteers are a hardy lot, but subject to frostbite. So we'll be back again in April. But do come to the store, by the way. You're in for a treat.
All right. I invite all who are able to stand, and let's sing our way out into God's world this week.
And all God's people said, Amen.
Amen. Our women, our children, our animals, our creation.
Thank you.
man. This is great. Thank you so much.
Steve, always a blessing to be around you. Yes, she's, wow, yeah, she's just expanding, blooming.
That was beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you for your voice. Thank you for your all of your musicality.
And thank you for the dance.
Yeah, it was fun.
Did you see us dancing?
No, I missed it. No,
oh, okay.
Dance.
Thank you.